So there we go. Now we're on. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Let's see. You ready, Scot?
I think I'm ready. Okay.
Here we go. Welcome to the 38th CALLERLAB Convention here in Las Vegas, Nevada. Today is Monday, April 18th. Are you having a good time?
Yeah.
All right. This is a session on modern square dance parties. Now, reading through this a moment ago, I just noticed they said after parties, and one of the sentences is not about after parties. If you think it's about after parties, that's a different session somewhere else. I don't know. This is about one-night stands or modern parties or square dance parties, okay? Are you clear about that? Great. I want to welcome you all to come this afternoon. We have to my left, my panelist is Mr. Scot Byars from, let's see, Sacramento, California, Elk Grove, no?
No, Sacramento.
Sacramento, okay. Scot calls in the Northern California area, all over Northern California. He calls all levels from beginners through C1, and he's been calling for at least 35 years, if not more.
41 years.
He's older than me. It's okay.
I am. I'm older than both of you.
That's right. He's older. Scot's well known. Scot's been a member of CALLERLAB for many, many years, and his wife Erin is somewhere around here. And Scot does lots and lots of parties, party nights, one-night stands throughout California. He and I exchange dates back and forth quite a bit when we can't do them, given the other person. So Scot is a great resource. If you have any questions, Scot's really, really an amazing entertainer. To my right, I have Mr. Rick Hampton. He comes from Visalia, California.
Hey.
Rick has also been calling for 37-something years and calls all levels. He teaches beginner classes every year, calls through C1. And Rick also, like myself, does a lot of party nights or one-night stands. Rick calls for clubs all throughout Southern California, the Bakersfield, Central California, and Southern California area. What we all have in common, besides living in California, is that we do regular square dancing that we all are familiar with, you know, beginners and mainstream and plus, and in this case we also do advanced and other things. But we also love doing party nights, one-night stands. We find that they're a lot of fun to do with our dance, with the people that hire us, and we have a lot of fun with them doing them. And over the years, we developed various programs that seem to work out where people enjoy them and have a good time and actually hire us back the next year. So that's always a good sign. If they hire you back, then you're probably doing something right. So, in this session, my name is Eric Henerlau. I'm from Corte Madera, California. I've been calling for 31 years, and And I also teach beginner classes every year, as well as call through plus, advance, and challenge. Okay, so I keep a full schedule of calling, and I do a lot of party nights as well. A little bit of history on party nights for me, and I'm going to pass the mic back and forth between the three of us to talk about how we approach party nights and one-night stands. And so what we hope that you get out of this is some ideas. And so take notes. Please get your pencil and paper out. Take notes. I'm going to play a couple of samples of some music. And if you have any specific questions, please feel free to address them to any one of us because it's important. If you do party nights, how many of you, I just want a real quick show of hands, how many of you actually do party nights or one-night stands right now? Okay. Hands down. How many of you don't do them but want to do them? So a couple of people don't do them but want to do them. Okay, great. But most of you already do them to some extent. I'm always surprised when I talk to some callers who are very good callers and traveling callers and even good local callers that don't do any party nights at all. They just don't do them. They have no connection with them. Yet they're very good callers, and you've seen callers like a very good caller, but they don't know how to do a party night or have a program for that. And I think it's a missed opportunity on a couple different levels. One, for one thing, you can just have fun doing it. Just pure fun. People are hiring you to have fun. If you're a fun person, you can give them fun, and it's a win-win situation. Nothing else happens. It's just great. There could be a place where you can connect with people who someday might want to learn how to square dance. No guarantees, but they might want to learn to take a regular square dance program someday. And three, and we'll get to this a little later, you can find that party nights could be some of the more lucrative parts of the calling business outside of regular square dancing. It's just kind of like a night in the world's day. Did you get it? Okay, great. We're getting one piece of equipment to plug in here. So we're going to talk a little bit about all of this here. And I hope that you get some information about this that you can take back and use. And really, if you already do party nights, since most of you do, use it to increase your program. And I also, if somebody has specific ideas or things that work really well for them, we'd love to have them brought forward, put on the microphone, put on the tape for everybody to take back. I see some faces out here who are very good at this and have a lot to offer. We're going to plug something in here right now. This goes in here. And give it a test.
Much better.
That works. I think that right. So, but of course, set the tone is you got to have something.
Yeah.
Anybody ever heard of it? Is it not this music?
All right, come on.
Now, if you don't know that music, you need to get that piece of music. It's a cha-cha slide. We're going to come back to that. But it's something you put on. If anybody in the room is under 25, they will immediately stand up and start dancing. You don't have to say a word of what to do. They will do it. And they'll all do it differently. It doesn't matter. But they're going to have a good time doing it because the guy's telling them on their thing what to do. So that's a piece of music here. What I want to talk about here, let me pull up my notes. There we go. All right. So I'm going to ask and go through a series of bullet points here. We're all going to discuss about how we do this, and if somebody has a specific question or comment about how they do it, I want them to hear that too. The first thing to go with is how you do party nights, how you get party nights. Now, we all get party nights different ways. Some people get them because they proactively go out and seek them. Some people get them because they get them through word of mouth, because people just know who you are and it comes out in the community. Some people get them because they have a good website or maybe an ad in the telephone book or some method like that. I have my only way of getting party nights is word of mouth, and I have a website for myself, and people seem to find me that way, and it gets me all the business that I really want doing that. How do you get yours?
Rick Hampton. SquareDanceParty.com is a site that I run. Use that. Certainly word of mouth. Referrals. You know, Eric can't do one. Like you mentioned, you'll trade with Scot. Norm back there and I have traded before. And talent agents. All kinds of ways of doing it.
Anybody here ever gotten a referral from a talent agency?
Mm-hmm. Many times.
Okay. We're going to come back to that in a second.
How do you get your...
Well, same way, basically. I have a website. People go to my website. They find out. They search. Actually, I've got several websites. But the last three that I got were through Gig Salad. Yeah. So Gig Salad is a website that allows you that basically puts your information or what you do out there on the web, and people can search it and say, okay, I'm looking for a score dance caller. And so, or they search for dancing, or they search for square dancing, and my name pops up. And, I'm pretty lucky that in California, I'm one of the few people in California that are on Gig Salad, so my name comes up. I got the last, now Rick is going to be on there, yeah, I know. But and the funny thing is I just did it as a fluke. I just went on their free site. I'm haven't paid for the professional version, like, because I don't believe in paying for stuff like that. I'm really cheap. But that's how I get it. I get it by referrals, websites, people just searching for me. If you have a website, one of the best ways to do that is through your meta tags. You know, go onto your meta tags and put in your key search and put in all of those things that you want to do. And the crawlers out there, like Google, will actually find it through your meta tags. So in your website, for those of you who don't know how to do that, you can search it out on Google how to do it, but you put in parties, Western country, Western line dancing, that kind of thing. I do a lot of that. I do a lot of country, Western, and line dancing. But we're eventually going to talk about this. Yeah. But all three of us are really interested in doing modern music. And I'll pass it back.
So he brings up a good point there. Beginner party nights like this, or we call them one-night stands in our area, or party nights, either way, same thing. they're not just square dancing for us. They're not just square dancing. If you only do square dancing, if you're just a square dance caller, you're going to need to broaden your horizons a little bit to be able to be successful at this. When I started doing these, you know, 25, 30 years ago, I was only a square dance caller. And so a party night looked a lot like simply doing the first night of a beginner class. Now, how does that work? It works to a point, right, if people want to learn that much about square dancing. But really what they want to have is a good time. They hired you to have a good time, whatever that's going to take for them to have a good time. So it's really not a recruitment vehicle to get them into your class. That may happen, but that's secondary. The important thing is that they have a good time, and you need to figure out how you're going to entertain the crowd in doing that. So here are some thoughts. Square dancing is part of the program, but not the entire program. Line dancing is usually part of the program. A lot of people do some kind. There's a whole handful of easy lines out there that can be done. There are circle dances, and circle mixers can be part of the program. And when you put all these together and you mix them all together, they form a good package that can entertain the crowd. And we're going to give you some examples of those in a minute. You want to add something to this?
Just a couple of things. If I saw some of your eyes glazing over when Scot was talking about meta tags and stuff. But basically, they're little invisible keywords hidden in the code. And after the session, ask Scot. He'll explain it to you. The other thing, too, is using one-night stands or square dance parties as a recruitment vehicle is probably counterproductive to both of your efforts. The folks at the party want to have fun. Chances are they do not want to sign up for 55 weeks of lessons. Okay? So mention it if you want. What I do is if someone asks, then I, it's not like, well, if you like this, why don't you come out next Friday?
Okay, we want to go to the next part. We got a lot of material here to cover in a short time. We're going to talk about how we negotiate contracts, okay? So I'm going to start with Scot. Do you need to get booted first?
No.
Okay.
That's for extra. What I do is I negotiate. When it comes to the party dances, I tend to negotiate a little hard. As a matter of fact, harder than I do in the square dance world. I ask for a minimum of $500. And the reason I do that is because if they were to hire a DJ to get out there and just play music, okay, they would have to spend $500 to $750 for a DJ. So I start with $500 and then $100 an hour after 3 hours. And that's what I do. Now, again, that's a hefty amount of money to do that. But understand that it's a lot more work than it is to call a square dance to do these party dances. Geographic area?
That you would do these parties in.
Oh, hell, I'll go anywhere. I'll go anywhere. No, but I would. But my area is pretty much anywhere in Northern California down to I've done a party in L.A. I've done a couple of parties in L.A., so I've done pretty much all of California.
Do you charge anything for extra mileage for the distance you're at?
Yes. If I have to go to Southern California or outside the state, yes, I would. I do charge extra. I charge a mileage for that, to do that. Negotiating the contracts, you know, I consider us super DJs. That's what I consider us, because we not only play the music, but we entertain the dancers and get out on the floor with the dancers and show them how to do these steps. So we are working for our money. We're worth that money. You know, so that's why I charge that much.
Yeah, pretty much what Scot said. I think, Eric, you actually generate the contract for the folks. I don't. What I do is we have the initial contact, whether it comes through the website or a referral or whatever. And once we get on the same page about who, what, when, where, how much, and so on, then I ask for a signed letter from them recapping that conversation along with a non-refundable deposit. The reason for the non-refundable deposit is a lot of times over the years, I've discovered that 2 days before an event, well, it turned out that Aunt Sally's 90th birthday was going to happen, so they canceled the event. So it's kind of a placeholder, and I charge between 20 and 25% of the fee for that.
Okay, and I when I negotiate a contract, I try to feel out, first of all, who's hiring me? What kind of organization is hiring me? Is this a bunch of Girl Scouts that are doing this, who might be a small group that have a small budget? Or maybe it's a large group. Maybe it's a private party for somebody who's turning 50 and they're inviting 200 of their closest friends. And let me tell you, my pricing for that is going to be very different. So in our area, I can my minimum is $400 for going out for a gig, and I've charged as much as $1,000, depending what the gig is, and, you know, what kind of event it is, and what kind of crowd it is, because you can look at the crowd and see what kind of budget they're going to be working with. I used to also get a letter from them saying, please write up in a letter everything we talked about, mail it to me, that's our contract. I've gone next step, which is actually draft a contract. I have a contract that I put together, an entertainment services contract, where I put, you know, their contact, our contact information. I find out, you know, all the details. I write into the contract about the location, the time, the hour. Is there alcohol served at the event? I want to know that. I'll still do the event. I don't mind, but it's going to be more money probably, right? Because it's just a little more effort on my part dealing with a bunch of drunks out there, right? I put little things in there, what I'm going to provide as a service, including I will play music in the genre of your choice, but not necessarily a specific song that you ask for. If you have a specific song, it's my contract, please provide me the CD and I'll play that song for you. It talks about the terms, exactly what you're going to pay me, the reconfirmation time, and I warrant, which is a promise, that I am licensed by BMI ASCAP to perform this music. Now, most people really don't care about that, but I'm putting that in my contract because my CALLERLAB license allows me to do that, you know, for these one-night stands and part of this. So I put that in there. I have also in here a formatted invoice, because some organizations, it could be a school that's hiring you, they want an invoice, or a corporation, they need an invoice to pay from. So I have that as part of the whole thing. So I have the standard format that I now email out to my clients, and they send it back to me or just reply back. They accept the terms, and that's good. So we're negotiating two things. We're negotiating how much you're going to charge based on who's hiring you, you know, what kind of people, what kind of group is hiring you, and how much do you think their budget might be. And the second thing is how you formalize that agreement. You could do it through a nice letter where you get everything detailed out, or I've kind of got a little more formal now with an actual contract they're going to sign and put together. Any questions or comments on that at this point before we move on to the next bullet point? Go ahead. Yeah.
State your name. My name is Matt Rainick from Colorado. One of the things I was taught when it came to negotiating anything, whether it's party dances or remodeling a house, which is what I do for a living, depending on the group, when they ask how much it's going to cost, I usually say, well, what do you have in your budget for this event? And let them start that process. If they say $50, say, I've got a number for you. Here's Scott's number. Otherwise, you don't want to start too low and leave quarters on the table.
Thank you. Okay, equipment. Equipment is a big deal, and I'm going to be direct about this. Not all square dance equipment is going to do the job for every party night out there. Some gigs you can use square dance equipment for, and some gigs just require something a little more power, a little more beef. And so that's something really to consider, depending on, you know, the kind of people you're going to be doing your program for, the kind of group it is, and what you think they're going to expect. If you think that group of people is going to be really happy with an old turntable here playing the 45s, well, fine. But most of the groups that I work for to do party nights aren't looking at turntables anymore, and they're looking at some kind of sound system that's going to provide something digital, whether it's a CD or a laptop or an MP3 player, and some kind of speaker system that's going to provide a robust sound. Doesn't have to be loud, but a robust sound that's beyond a yak stack. Okay, so this is something to think about when you're going to go out there and do, you know, a high quality party night out there and really get the kind of fees that you can get for doing a good program. Is look at the sound system you have. Rick, tell us about yours.
For most things, I do use a Hilton 205, which is actually a pretty workhorse amplifier. But I use a two-way 12-inch woofer horn tweeter speakers for larger events. You know, that'll accommodate pretty much anything you might see in the regular square dance world, crowd size-wise. Larger, I have a Behringer mixer, 600-watt laptop, and if it's a really big thing, I'd go down to soundstage and rent some stuff.
Usually in those cases, I have a 550-watt stereo amplifier that I use. It's a gem sound. It's 550 watts per channel. And then I use a Behringer mixer to do that. I'm always using a wireless mic. That's important to me. I couldn't survive doing a party dance without a wireless microphone. And so my current wireless flavor of the year is the new Micro, the Samson Micro headset microphone. And it's over, goes over the left ear and then around the front, and that's the only transmitter is here. And the receiver is this little matchbox thing with two little antennas out of the front. It's really cool. It's very crisp, very clear, and it really works well when I'm out there doing line dancing in the splits with the teenagers. I do. Yes, this is a brand new. It is FCC compliant, and Wood does it. It's a UHF microphone, and it has no power plug-in for it. It only recharges. It has a lithium-ion battery in both the headset and the mic and the receiver, and so you don't have to mess with plugging it into power. You just put it out there on the table, extend the antennas, turn it on, you're done. It's a wonderful little microphone. In the past, I used a UHF Samson. I think it's the AX1 is what it was. And it was a little unit that had XLR connection that you can take your regular microphone that you use, your ND257 or 267, pop it right on there, and it makes it wireless. So I used that for years. We still use that for things. So that's the extent of my equipment.
And I've seen him use that new mic. It's really cool. It's beige color, so for his skin tone, it just blends right in. You can't even see it. It's just right there. I use.
Put it up against my legs.
No, you don't put it up against your legs. No, that's good. For the Samson.
Which Samson?
The headset.
Okay. It's called the Micro. The Micro Samson headset. It's called Micro. Sweetwater has it. That's the only place I've been able to find it is on Sweetwater's website. D&H has it now. Lawrence tells us. Okay. So.
Moses was a Cajun.
He was Moses.
Eight
step line dance. Eight steps to it. And it takes about 10 seconds to teach this every party night. You don't have any Moses on there. Get Ants Moses. Good one. We're going to put music in here. I'll throw it out. Okay. So I use, I don't even use it. I don't have a Hilton anymore. I've got a rack mount amplifier. That's what I use for all my square dance gigs at this point. And it's a mixer with a 400-watt amplifier, 400 watts per channel. I use that with a couple of EVSX-200 speakers. And that's my standard setup, unless it's a really big gig. And then I'll have another amplifier and a crossover and a couple of subwoofers. Now, some of you are glazing over going, ah, that's a lot of equipment. I mean, it gets kind of complicated. It doesn't get that complicated. It can get complicated, but it doesn't have to be. I kind of have a lot of stuff going on there. Greg Anderson back there has got a great set. Greg, do you want to tell us a little bit about the set you have?
Greg Anderson, Colorado. A few years ago, all my stuff got stolen out of my car, and I had to shop for new equipment, and Cal Campbell told me about the Bose PAS system, also referred to as Bose Stick. I love it. It's heavy, but that's okay. I want good quality sound. It's got a 7-foot tall column in two pieces and a bass unit, which they've scaled down in size. I've got the first version that's big and heavy. 750-watt amplifier, 22 speakers in the column, plus the subwoofer, real high quality, puts out superb sound. Yes, I'm hauling more around, but I just love it. I end up using my Hilton MA-150 just as a mixer because I'm familiar with the controls, and I patch all my sound into that. You can use it without, you know, just use the corded remote with the Bose. They're currently selling for $2,400, something like that. Excellent piece of equipment.
Thank you, Greg. But if you do like 5 gigs, you pay for it, right?
Yeah. I mean, and people who have gone to any movie theater in the last decade with THX sound, they expect good quality sound. And I started upgrading my equipment several years ago when I had my Blue Hilton. Yes, I wasn't using records. I had quit using records long ago. But I finally started, until I upgraded to some other equipment about 15, 20 years ago, I can't remember what, I started covering up the Blue Hilton with a black cloth so they couldn't see it, because one guy came up and started laughing. He says, "What's that?" And so, yes, upgraded equipment is a good thing.
It's Cupid Shuffle. Okay, so for those of you who knew it, for those of you who don't know it, write it down. Cupid Shuffle, buy it off iTunes, 99 cents. I don't know. This one's DJ Godfather. That's like, there's like 10 different people that do them. Well, I got one by, this is DJ Godfather who does it. The original is by Cupid, fine. It's called Cupid Shuffle, buy it on iTunes or Amazon, okay? Get it? Because they tell you in the song what to do. You just put it on, they just tell you what to do. To the right, to the right, to the left, you'll turn around, that's it. You're done. You don't have to do anything, it's wonderful. Well, that's the best thing, you know. You get people to entertain themselves, get them going on this thing. So we talked a little bit about the sound systems here. There's a variety of sound systems. What's important to learn out of this? You can use square dance equipment, but you're going to have to think bigger than that in some cases. You know, you have to think bigger because your audience is not looking for, they're looking for something a little bit more than maybe what you're used to providing for a small club workshop where you could just use a Yak and a Micro 75 and a couple of records. It's going to be something bigger than that for a party night type thing. How you structure your evening is very important. You're there for however long you're there for. On my contracts, I say I'm there for 4 hours. That's how I bid it, because I say, I'm going to charge you this, but I'm there for a four-hour block of time. Well, I only need you for half an hour. That's okay. I'm there for a four-hour block. This is what I charge. And if it doesn't work, then I don't get the contract. I'm okay with that, because I know what my time is worth to me. So this is what I charge. So how you structure your program is really important. A lot of events are things like a fundraiser or a social event for a church or a Girl Scout get-together, or I do one for the Indian Princesses, I think it's YMCA, Indian Guides, Indian Princess, and there's an evening structure they have. It's really important for you to find out how they've structured their evening. You know, are they going to have a dinner? Are they going, then when the dance is going to happen, and they're going to have prizes or announcements or how it's going to wrap up, and you got to get that schedule laid out in front of you, because what you want to do is be everything for them. You really want to be everything for them, not just the square dance part they're talking about, but they don't really know what they're asking for when they're hiring you. They don't really know. They think they're asking for square dancing, but you need to come and provide a whole package of entertainment. That's part of your fee, because that's why you charge what you charge. So you're there. When they contact me, I tell them, I'm there for your entire event. I'm there for your event. When are your guests coming? I'll be set up by that time. I'll be playing background music, you know, as they're coming in the door, welcoming them in, whatever it is. I can play background music during dinner. I got a whole bunch of songs on here, you know, I can have a lot of stuff. What time do you want to start dancing? We'll do the dance at this point. And depending on the kind of crowd it is, there may be a point where they're just done. They're just done with square dancing. You know, it's only so long you can get somebody talking to you, telling you do this, do that, right? They're done with structured dancing. And they just want to relax and shake it out there, whatever. And so you got to get to that point in your program where you're going to stop doing your instruction and just play other music they can just dance to. So how you structure your program is very important. Now, specifically when you get to the part where, you know, that part where we're doing our job, just talking to the microphone, doing the square dancing, how you break that down is important too. Do you want to go first, Scot?
Sure. I usually start the program, let me back up and reiterate what Eric is saying. It is important that you do the entire program. Now, every once in a while, you get the opportunity to work with a live band, and sometimes they will ask you if you can work with a live band, and I just absolutely love it. And sometimes they ask you for suggestions for a live band. Now, usually those are corporate events. And when you get those are the ones that pay the best, are the corporate events. I did one for Myers Sound, I don't know if you're familiar with Byars. They create speakers for theater systems, and they're international. And I did a gig for them in a winery in Sonoma with the Ghostwriters, if you guys are familiar with them. So I did the one-night stand. I did the party. The Ghostwriters were the backup. They did all of my music. I didn't have to worry about that. They did it. We got to use these fabulous Byars equipment. It was absolutely phenomenal stuff. And I walked away with nearly $1,000 on that gig. So... But how I structure it, I forgot. That's what you want me to do. How I structure it is I always start out with one or two line dances. That's how I start out with. Because I find that people can get up. They'll get up by themselves where they're kind of shy about getting up with someone else. Even the men will get up with certain line dances, playing certain music. Well, one of the most easy ones is to get up with electric slide. You do electric slide, and you teach that. Now, I look out in my audience, and I see who's out there dancing, and I look at their age, and I look at what they're trying to do, and some of them are trying to do hip-hop, so I'll add a little hip-hop in what we're doing into that. I'll add things to it. Once I've done a couple, maybe one or two line dances, I'll start with a mixer, a couple mixer. I'll do a Redneck's version of Cotton Eye Joe. I'm sure you have that. That isn't it. That's it.
I've been married a long time ago. Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from?
So I do a really simple mixer with this. It starts with the right foot. We have the ladies on the outside, the men in the middle facing opposite directions, holding right hands. And we start with stomp, stomp, side, close, side. Now, I add a little humor in it because I don't play the music at the beginning of this. What I do is I go through the teaching of the dance and everything, and then I say, oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you, this is really fast. And it's long, too. Yes. So boom, boom. And so they're doing this, and you see the kids like going, yeah, this is fast, I love it. And the adults are going, this is long. But they do it, and they enjoy it. They have a great time with it. Following that, then I'll start them in a big circle. We'll get into a big circle. Then I'll start them into squares. I'll pick someone's name, and I'll say, okay, lead to the... I want so-and-so here. Everybody let go of hands. I'm sorry, everybody hang on hands, but Jim, right? Jim's there. And so Jim lets go of his corner, and I say, Jim, I want you to lead, and I want you to go to the right, and I want you to pick up eight people, including yourself. And so from that point on, we get people into smaller circles, and then we start getting them into squares. So that's how I do that. I'll eventually go back to a line dance or two, and I may throw in some country western in the middle of that. So.
My program, there's actually, we're going to talk about some absolutes later on, so we'll cover that there. But I start out with a large circle and then work my way into squares. And one thing you got to understand is sometimes you're never going to get into squares in the whole evening. The squares may have 10 couples in them. They may have 3 couples in them. In these kind of cases, you go with the flow. You know, so right and left grand takes 5 hands, well, so be it. If it takes 3 hands, so be it. And then throw in things like Cotton Eye Joe, Rednecks, or the Cha-Cha Slide, which is the one that Eric played right now. Oh, this is the freeze. This is a great little kid one. And it's very popular with my wife's kindergarten class. She's sitting back there laughing at me. But anyway, just interjecting various things in between squares and or circles, depending. You know, I did one here just a week or two ago, and it was perfect. We had 4 squares, and they danced the whole night. It was great. sometimes it doesn't work that way. Sometimes you get, you know, and people want to dance with the folks they want to dance with. So you may have a circle of 10 people here that are, no way are they going to break up. It doesn't matter. Especially the kids. And you might have a group over here that's got 7 people in it. All I do ask, though, is when I do teach, the first thing I teach is do-si-do, is I have everybody face their partner, and then if you're not looking at a face, raise your hand, because we do have to have even number of people in these things.
That was The Freeze. If you don't know that song, it's The Freeze. Write that one down. Get that. It's The Freeze. And put that on. Kids will do that instantly. There's nothing for you to say. The record tells them everything to do. They freeze and they dance on. They all love that one.
Do you have the funky hooky
pooky? I have various versions of that. I'm going to add a few more in here that you should know about as well. We talked about the Cotton Eye Joe. There is actually a dance called Cotton Eye Joe. Oh, going back to the Cupid Shuffle we talked about a minute ago, my wife and I went dancing at Gilly's down here at Treasure Island 3 nights ago. It's a dance, country western dance place, and we do a lot of country western dancing. Right in the middle of that, Cupid Shuffle went on, and there we are. We're all doing the Cupid Shuffle out there. Again, everybody knows what to do. Cotton Eye Joe, the original Cotton Eye Joe. This is an old square dance version of it. And you can teach Cotton Eye Joe. It's pretty straightforward. I teach us to dance, and they go through it. And we get going, and I go into it about 30 seconds and say, no, you don't have the idea. And then I show them, this is really it. And then we start over again. And I put on the Rednecks version, the one we talked about. This is the one that really gets them going, because it's the same tempo, but it feels a lot faster. Have you heard this one? You can pick it up. It's called Cotton Eye Joe and Rednecks, R-E-D-N-E-X-X. All these 1X, 1X, R-E-D-N-E-X, and you can pick this up off iTunes or Amazon. And it's the same song, Cotton Eye Joe, but in a very techno way that just people get lit up on that one. This song down there. You got to have all these things in your arsenal. You have to have this. You got to have the standard, of course. Everybody has to have... or some variation of that, right? Hey. Or it could look like, you know. I got 4 versions of Ernie Dance. Go figure. I don't know why. I just do. But because everybody does it. Again, you put on Nobody Has to Be Told. Do you have the bunny hop? Now, this is stuff that's happening in book business, because here's what's going to happen. You're going to get booked for a gig, and they're all going to be there, and you thought you asked all the questions, and you got there, and they forgot to tell you that all their 5-year-old kids are with them, too.
Right.
And they're all going to dance. And you have this whole program lined up for square dancing, all this great complicated square dance stuff, and you got a bunch of 5-year-olds out there, and now you're thinking, oh, what am I going to do? And part of your arsenal, and it's having, you have to have these tools in your toolbox. You've got to have your list of songs that are going to work, like the bunny hop, like the cha-cha slide, like the birdie dance, like Amos Moses, Bebopalooza, the freeze, all these ones. The hokey pokey. I've got 4 versions of the hokey pokey. Go figure. You know, but people all will do that, and you got to have those things. You got to have some of the circle dances, like Tennessee Wigwalk. These are goofy dances, but you got to have them in your arsenal because you don't know exactly when you're going to use them, but you got to have them as part of that. If you've only been doing square dance party nights for adults, you're used to doing just square dancing, fine. But when you get to have kids around, a lot of that square dance stuff doesn't fly very well for a 6-year-old who can't really process all the instructions you have. So you have to find ways to communicate in a fun time with a large variety of people out there. Now, here's something else that I noticed for myself and might change how I do party nights. I do the YMCA one every year with the Indian princess. Father-daughter, right? Anybody ever done a father-daughter type dance where you get the tall father and the 6-year-old daughter, right? Okay, and you work it, and dad's usually paying attention to what's going on and gets the daughter to do it, right? And you can kind of work it out. But then you get the dad who's got the 2 daughters, right? Maybe a 6- and 7-year-old daughter, and they both cling on to dad's leg because that's just how they are, right? They're having fun. And so you're trying to teach calls like right and left grand or whatever, and in your world you're thinking, well, this is how you do the call, but they're not executing it correctly. And I used to think about that. Well, how do you do a square that's got 9 or 10 people in it because the kids are hanging on to the parents' legs, right? They do it. The parents, if you watch closely, the parents don't care. They don't care at all. They're going to do something that looks like a right and left grand. It might be a right and left grand. It might be something else. And they'll find somebody. They're going to promenade. And they're going to do whatever they do, and they're going to have a great time. So you need to give up any idea of anybody actually doing anything correctly. And you could have 9 or 10 people in that square, and you're going to call the best you can and serve a suggestion about how things should be, and they're going to interpret it and do whatever they think it might look like, and somehow it's all going to work out. And what you're looking for is whether or not they're laughing and smiling at the end and having a good time. I start out my program in the evening with the circle, the big circle like these guys are talking about, and then I break off into squares, and we'll do that for a short bit. I'll do a line dance, usually take a break, then I circle back. Next step, I'll do a square, line dance, circle mixer, maybe a Cotton Eye Joe or a Tennessee Wigwalk, maybe even Patty Cake Polka. I haven't used that in a while, but I could use that. And then take another break, and then circle around again. I'll do three or four sets this way. And a lot of people don't do this, but I always teach grand square on my one-night stands. Some people say, well, it's too complicated. You can't do that. Now, it takes a few minutes to teach that call, but when people get it, they are so turned on. They'll walk away going, that was the coolest thing I've ever done, because the grand square is really the coolest thing. Once they get it, it takes a few minutes, but then, yeah, that's really great. So it's worthwhile doing all that stuff. Yeah.
Like I mentioned, there's a section on absolutes, but like Eric mentioned, you're going to have a case where you're expecting adults and you find that there's a bunch of kids there. One of the things, one of my absolutes, is I do ask, will there be little children at the event? And they say yes. What I highly encourage the folks to do is I'll do the first 15 or 20 minutes of, in that case, of the chicken dance, things like that. And then I highly, highly suggest to the sponsor, this is at the negotiation process, that they provide an alternative activity for the really little ones, because nothing ruins a party like some three-year-old face down, no teeth, blood coming out of his mouth. That happened. That's when that became an absolute for me.
So one of the things I asked my panelists here, what their biggest successes were, and maybe some of their worst flubs were, because, you know, you need to learn from your successes and also all your mistakes. And I can tell you some of my biggest successes were doing corporate events, large corporate events, where you have all the equipment in place and you're all set up, you're dressed well, you have all your equipment looking professional. Sometimes I bring cloths to drape over my equipment, even though it's rack mount, and you're doing that well, and you give a good program, and you have everything working right. Those are some of the biggest ones. Some of my worst failures, or not failures, but flubs, doing an event somewhere on the top of a hill, outdoors, in a dirt field. Have you ever had that before? And you're playing your record watching the dust settle on the record as it's playing, right? Or your laptop, as you're watching the dust come onto the keyboard of your laptop because the horse is walking by. And everybody's dancing on the hard dirt, kicking up dust all around in the hot sun as your equipment becomes caked in dust. I used to charge more for doing those gigs. I don't even do them anymore. If it's going to be outdoors, I refer them off to somebody else, usually Scot. But I don't like all the dust all over my equipment. Rick?
Some of his biggest successes are the outdoor ones. Eric referred to them. Couple of cool ones was doing a thing at an aviation hangar for 800 airline employees. And that was just, it was a clicking evening because they knew exactly what they were getting. And because it turned out that particular gig, about half the ownership of the airline square danced. And it was kind of like a friendly, we are square dancing, right? Did one at the Nixon Presidential Library. That was cool. Probably the biggest flub was the kid's teeth and the blood. Probably that one. Chasing, we're doing an outdoor, well, it wasn't exactly an outdoor event. They were outside. I was inside a barn. And then it started raining. Really raining. A lot.
I did a gig once outdoors with a live band, and it did start raining. And it would stop. So it would stop. And then when it rained, we covered everything up. We stopped. And then the rain would stop, just briefly. So we uncovered it. We started playing again. And then the rain would come again, so we had to cover everything up again. And this went on for three or four cycles. And it was just drops of rain, not much. But there's a lot of electronic equipment outside. And the person sponsoring the party, the next time the rain came, and we started to stop, said, don't stop. The rain will just stop again. Just keep going. Just keep going. Don't just keep going through the rain. Keep going through the rain. And the musicians who have a stand-up bass, you know, a wooden bass, and all this other electronic equipment around there, they said, no, we're covering our equipment up. We're not going to get rained on here. So one of the things to look at, if you're doing an outdoor thing, make sure you have accommodations for if the weather turns bad. Scot?
Yeah. Well, actually, one of my worst ones that I just had just recently, we were not outside, we were in a barn. Yeah, in Petaluma. We're in a barn, and to cut down the dust, they threw hay on the floor.
Oh, it was horrible. I'm out there doing line dancing, or I'm doing some, and it's like I've developed this pile that's 6 inches high, and I'm tripping over my own feet on that. And the worst part about it is I couldn't get them up to square dance at all. I've never had that problem before. But these people, the perfect age group. Oh, my God, if you could get the perfect group that you would want to turn into a square dance club. They were 30 years old. All of them were 30 years old, they were young, they were smart, they were intelligent, and the guys were all drunk. And, yeah. I'm sorry, I did. Yeah, I told them first. Yeah, now that, what she's referring to was the one that I did for Myers Sound. And that was an excellent one. We did another one several years ago when we were in Southern California in Palm Springs. And we did one, John Walters was the one who gave us the gig. And it was for his company. And we had probably about 500 people there, something like that. The food was absolutely wonderful. We had steak, we had ribs, we had chicken. It was just absolutely great. It was a wonderful time. And being in Palm Springs, the weather was great. It was just beautiful. Now, some of the worst ones was many years ago, where you'd do a one-night stand or a party out there, and you'd watch in the heat outside, you'd watch your record turn into an ashtray. You just watch it on the turntable go like this. And, I mean, some of those were some of the worst times. I don't know how many records I've gone through. That's one of the reasons why I went digital. I didn't want to lose any more records, so I started going. I went to mini discs, and I started working on mini discs, and then from there went to computers. So,
I want to hear from you. Does anybody have any real horror story out there? I bet somebody's got a horror story out there about a one night stand. And what we can learn from what it was, and what we can learn from it, so that we can prepare better for our next event.
I'm Dick Lee from Cocoa, Florida. We got a call one night to do a gig for the Mormon kids. They were doing a walkabout. They were out there all week out at their ranch. I don't know how many of you are familiar, but the Mormons own about 50 square miles of cattle ranching in the state of Florida. And the people didn't want any power. We couldn't drive our vehicle out there to carry our equipment. They were going to truck us out. We had to park up by the gate. They were going to supply music because we couldn't have power. So what we did was we put everything on the computer. These kids had been pulling big carts. They went in families, like 8 or 9 to a family. And what it did was simulate when the Mormons came from up north and went to Utah. They spent all week out there tugging these big carts around and sleeping on the ground at night. So we automatically figured, well, this ain't going to be any good at all. But we took the gig. And we're sitting at the gate waiting on them to come pick us up. And we're wondering how we're going to do music. We carried the computer with us. But anyway, we're wondering how we're going to have any music. So this guy pulls up, and he gets out of his car, and he's got a violin case in his hand. I said, oh, you're the fiddle player. He said, well, no. He said, I'm a concert violinist. Okay, you're going to play country western songs? Well, I don't know any country western songs. I said, well, I've got sheet music, but, you know. So anyway, the second guy shows up. He's another concert violinist. They don't know each other. They've never played together. Another guy shows up with a guitar. And what else do we have? We had an accordion. None of these guys knew each other. They had never played together. They trucked us out to this remote site out in the middle of this cattle ranch. They took the power away from us. We cheated. Like I said, we had the computer with us so we could at least see some words on the music. We're on this cart with straw all over it and everything. And we're out there waiting and waiting and waiting. And these kids start coming in. And then they eat dinner. And we ate with them, and everything was hunky-dory. And I said, these kids are going to be so tired, they ain't never going to get up and dance. So we finally started the dance about 8:30.
at 10 o'clock when we were supposed to knock off. These kids didn't want to quit. We had about run out of music. So it turned out to be a great experience, but it started out really, these guys were phenomenal, these musicians. Within 30 minutes, they were together. They were playing whatever music we gave them. And we had sheet music with us, and they played whatever we gave them to play. And they were absolutely phenomenal. But I'd never had an experience like that, and I could just see that falling down around my ears. You want to mic?
Yeah, I'll try. Jim Watts, Riverdale, Maryland, third annual of what I thought was going to be a forever event. I'm not sure they're going to call me again. New equipment, the FCC rules, microphone change, and I shifted over to a new microphone. And I had tied into their sound system before, but I had used my speakers as well. They insisted I not do the latter this time. And so it sounded great while there were no people in the barn. After there were people in the barn, nobody heard me. Nobody heard me. Really awful. So if I get called back again, I'm not sure I will. My speakers are going up, and I'll tie into their system.
We talk about music, too. When I actually start out, first time through, I'm not going to put anything too complicated to use music. I always start my part time for some reason, my one night stand with this piece of music, which is sounds like regular square dance music, doesn't it? It's not. You know this music? No, it's Bluesberry Hill by the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band. It's an instrumental song. It's actually pop music. Came out several years ago. It's all instrumental. It's a great piece of music. It's a Nitty Gritty Dirt Band, so it's really good music all the way around. I'll start them out, I'll get them going on something like that. But then shortly after that, when we start moving on, it's going to go right on to Bluesberry Hill by Nitty Gritty Dirt Band. As soon as you start getting this, if you got anybody under 50 in that room, they'll start dancing along because they know the song, because this is Love Shack from the 70s. And I call right over, because this is a great alternative music. Call right up. Now we're dancing, we're doing some kind of square dance stuff going on. They got this going back. They're all shaking and rattling and rolling with this because they like the song, right? Their whole experience, everybody's smiling at this point. Moving on. The next tip comes along, and I might use something like this. This is an 80s version of Venus, a 60s pop song by Bananarama. And they'll get into that. Or something like that. A lot of you have a line dance. Ooh, ah. You have the ooh, ah line dance. You can buy this one. This is a version of Love Potion number 9 called Ooh, ah. And if we use it for pattern, I mean, all these are patterns. I use all of this kind of music stuff, is, and I want to emphasize the alternative pattern side of this, because these are all modern square dance parties, not just the fiddler on the haystack up there, because that's not always the image you want to bring across to everybody. We have songs like that, like this, But we want to make sure that we have a variety of stuff to give them, especially something that's going to appeal to their senses. And you can get that immediately when you start putting the music on or whatever you're saying. If they're smiling and they're responding to you, you're doing it right. It makes no difference what you're doing as long as they're smiling and they're having a good time. Norman.
Norman Proshaw from California. I had a one-night stand at a country club. They had an hour, social hour, and some of the guys were pretty ripped. And we got squared up, and they were talking, and I would have had to take my 300 and kick it onto tandem and crank the sound up to get over them. So I just put the mic down, backed up to the wall, and sat there. And all of a sudden, one guy turned around and looked at me, and he says, "He's pissed." And the entire group went, and I got up and I said, "Hey, we can have fun tonight, or you can talk." And we had fun all night long. But I didn't know any other way to quiet him down other than to shut up and lean against the wall. And it worked.
Next time, ask for a volunteer. That shuts him up right away.
There you go.
I want to play some of the music that I use for patter. And again, it depends on the group that's out there, because I'm always analyzing my floor to see who's out there, what their age is, what kind of music they like. Sometimes I ask them. But this is a piece of music that I use that I stole from my wife. It was a round dance. Let's see if I've got sound coming out of this. Legally purchased. And they just move. It's called Black Horse and a Cherry Tree. It is by ATR. Yeah. Alright, so let me look at some other stuff that I do. Black Horse and a Cherry Tree. Now, depending upon the ethnicity of my group that I have out there, and in California, we're bound to have, you know, different nationalities out there. I might do this one. Yes. Just wait for a moment. It's Tayo Cruz. With Ludacris. It's called Break Your Hearts. Roll about on the front and call over to your heads. Up to the middle and I come on back. Head square through the mega tree. Full hands in around again. So it's very callable. Here's another one that I do. This is kind of an easier one. This one is by Black Eyed Peas. It's called I Got a Feeling.
Flash Mother saw her Chicago to Oprah Winfrey, 20,000 people out there in Chicago to this song, I Got a Feeling, Black Eyed Peas. Everybody under 30 is going to know this song instantly in the first two notes. And you can call right over this. We don't want to make this an alternative patter session, but, I mean, this kind of stuff is going to be turning them on because they have the cues for you. It's the song part of it. You can get the instrumental version of the song. Go online for 99 cents. You can get the karaoke version without the vocals if you want. You don't want to sing over the vocals. Get it either way. Exact same thing. We're gonna show you a couple of songs here.
I need the little thingy there, Scot. Never mind. Hang on a minute. Some folks are either unaccustomed or uncomfortable going to iTunes or stuff like this. I'm going to play you two or three examples of things that feel really modern, really alternative. They're all produced by Square Dance labels. This particular one's called Hoedown of the Phantom. It's on Blue Star. It's an orange record. Do we have any? Oh, yes, we do have some stuff from the Youth Music Project. I can't remember the names of the stupid things. Power of Love.
They all start with SS.
That's exactly right. They all start with S. This is one that I produced, California Love. I don't remember the original artist, but this was produced by a Square Dance label. Tupac. California Love. cutting the rug. Thank you. Cutting the rug, also on Sharpshooter. Okay, so those are just a few things that have been put out by Square Dance labels. So.
Okay. To wrap this up, because we're almost out of time here, I just want to add in here, it's important to look at the music, it's important to look at your sound systems, it's important to understand your audience, really, really important to understand your audience. Don't come in there with saying you're going to do this and have your audience be something else. I got booked a couple of months ago for a birthday party for a 7-year-old girl. Now, that's not my forte, it was just for her 7-year-old friends, you know, that was it, no adults. I did the gig. I did it. It was at someone's house in their living room, of all places, and I did it. I still charge what I charge. You know, it comes down to it. This is what I charge, and they're willing to pay it. They had the money. So I came and did my gig, and I stood there, and I was professional, and I did the event. And I went all the way through the event, and I did it. It wouldn't be the event I would seek out to do. But it becomes a line where you're professional about it, and you're saying, you know what? I'm going to charge this fee, and if you're going to pay it, I will come in and I will do a really good job. And that's what you do.
They always turn into something else.
And you have a good time doing it, and you do your job, and you have to be professional. You will have gigs like what Norman was talking about, where everybody's drunk, and they're not going to do anything. And you have to kind of find a line for yourself. They hired you, you're professional, you do your job, whatever that looks like, so that at the end, they're going to walk away thinking, you know, okay, they had a great time, we're glad they hired you, maybe we'll hire you back next year, whatever it might be. Keep in mind, just because they're drinking doesn't mean you get to drink. You might drink, but that doesn't mean that you should, because at the end of the day, when you walk away, they're going to hand you a check, and sometimes they'll hand you more money. Sometimes get really nice tips on top of that, and you don't want to do anything to compromise that with any kind of questionable behavior or language or anything that would get in the way of them referring you to somebody else. You always want to walk away being perfectly referable to anybody, because if somebody calls you up next week and says, well, can you give me a reference, like can anybody, any gigs you've done before in the past? Well, yeah, let me have you call Susie from last week or Bob from 2 weeks ago or Julie from 3 weeks ago. You don't ever want to walk away with it kind of being questionable. You want to walk away with them smiling and saying, man, I cannot wait to have them back again. Does anybody want to have any closing remarks before we wrap up today?
I was going back to the contract things. If you happen to be working with a talent agency, you're working under their contract, and you're bound by the terms of their contract. For example, it's very typical that if you're doing an event that the talent agency hired you for, you can't pass out your own business cards. You have to pass out the business cards the talent agency typically provides for you. Say Rick Hampton, Square Dance caller, but it's got the talent agency's name, address, and phone number on it. And the other thing, too, when you're first negotiating, someone mentioned, ask what the budget is. Another good question is, who's catering it? And if they say, oh, it's going to be, and it doesn't matter what they say, that's a good idea of what the budget might be.
If it's a potluck event, you know it's a different budget.
Barry Hendricks, Arlington, Texas. No, I'm not John Jones. He's taller than I am. A success story, guys. 20 years ago, I got hired to do an event for an outfit called the Ulster Project, which is bringing 18 to 24 teenagers from Belfast to Arlington, Texas for 3 weeks. They do everything. The last Thursday that they're there, we show them what Thanksgiving looks like. And at that event, we have a square dance party. And the square dance party is, well, from what they tell me, and they've hired me back for 20 years, is the highlight of the 3 weeks that the kids go back to Ireland talking about.
Wow. All right. Any other final comments before we wrap up? One more.
Dan Claremont, Southern California, Mission Viejo. I was given a great word of advice from a mentor of mine who most of you know, Lee Schmidt, and he referred me to a lot of square dance party nights. And one of them, he said, the very first question out of your mouth should be, how many people are going to be there? And I said, why? And he said, well, if they have over 400 people, you tell them it's $2 a head. They don't think it's $800. He says, you can say $3 a head and they won't even blink. He goes, that's $1,200. He goes, so start thinking about it as dollars per head, and people are willing to pay $3 a head. And now if they only have 50 people coming, you want to do more than $2 a head, obviously, or do your minimum. But that was a great word of advice, and it's really helped me.
We want to thank you all for coming. If you have specific questions and want a copy of the generic calling contract, which I have, or any of the songs that any of the three of us provided today, please email any one of us, and I can send you that information. We won't email you the songs. We'll email you the names of the songs, okay? Yeah, and I'll email you the contract that I use. So thank you all for coming this afternoon. I hope you have a great evening.